Well, greetings, brethren, and welcome to everyone. Glad to see everyone here today. The title of this particular message is Be Nice. Be Nice. Brethren, I was sitting in my classroom some 52, 53 years ago when I can remember my teacher walked in. Now, he was a very big man, but he was also a very nice man. Yet he had the tendency of putting some of his students on the spot. By that, I mean by asking them what I thought, even at that time, were rather personal questions. Well, there I was. I was ready to learn, when he did that to me. He asked me a question that I wasn't prepared for, because I never thought he would do that to me. But then he asked me a question that I became somewhat tensed with, and he called out my name. And he said, "Alvin." Of course, I kind of jumped like that. "Alvin." "Yes, sir." Well, I didn't say that, but I said, "Yes, sir." At least I'm hoping I did. He said, "Alvin, do you see that girl over there?" And of course, I looked over there. And I said, "Yes, I do." And then he pops the question in his own unique fashion. I remember he sat on his desk and he just sat there and looked at it and started smiling at me. And when he asked the question, it brought on a little laughter from some of the students. And if not answered correctly, it could have set the mood for the rest of the class, for the rest of the period. At least it could have set the mood for me and that girl over there. The teacher asked me, "Alvin, do you think so-and-so is pretty?" And I remember the smile. He knew he had me right then. Well, there it was. And in my opinion, at that moment, I felt like I need to answer this question, and I need to answer this question quickly, so that it would not appear to the other students that I was having a difficult time answering that question. That I thought maybe the longer I would have to delay answering the question, they would think, "Well, he thinks she's ugly." And I didn't want them to think that, although I was. But I wasn't trying to, I was trying to figure out some way I could get out of this. She wasn't ugly, but she wasn't all that attractive, and if the light had hit her right, she could go either way. I was becoming rather embarrassed, and I felt maybe she was becoming a little bit embarrassed. But brethren, I was on the spot. I didn't want to answer, "No, I don't think she's pretty at all. Whoa." Nor did I want to say, "Yes, I think she's very pretty." Because you see, brethren, even back then, I tried to be just a good old boy. I tried to be honest and I tried to be truthful, at least to a point. And there was the point, right there in front of me. And yet after a very few quick seconds, I answered the teacher's question, "Did I think she was pretty?" And I said, "Yes, I do." She wasn't unattractive, but she was far from becoming the next prom queen. But how do I answer that question? So I said, the question was one that I couldn't think of a brilliant reply. So I just simply said, yes, I do. I didn't want to hurt her feelings because I wanted to be nice. But I wanted to be truthful, simply meaning that I wanted to be kind. I wanted to be pleasant. And yes, I wanted to be tactful while being truthful and nice. I mean, I wanted to practice, you know, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I wanted to practice some of the commandments, especially in dealing with relationships with each other. I didn't want to lie, but I wanted to tell the truth, but I wanted to be tactful about it. You see, brethren, she wasn't ugly, but she was more pretty in other ways besides physical beauty. Now, all these things were running through my mind in those 4 or 5 split seconds. At least I hope they were, because I was still trying to get over him calling my name. I would usually, at that time when I was younger, I would usually be over concerned about a lot of things. Sometimes that was good, and sometimes being over concerned about certain things brought on a lot of unnecessary worry. That still happens to me today. So having given a truthful answer, as I saw it, the mood of the class remained stable. The girl's feelings, I don't believe she was offended or hurt. And yes, I felt better. I had been truthful, and I felt like I had been tactful, giving the answer, because deep down in my gut, she was pretty, but for other reasons besides beauty. So I gave the answer, and I said, yes, I just didn't go into detail. I just simply left it at that. Yes, I think she's pretty. You know, for the time I had known that girl in that classroom over the past few months, I had already been impressed with her because of her demeanor. Now, I didn't know the word back then, but I was impressed with her outward behavior, which is what that means. She had always seemed to be calm, quiet, a quiet person with a pleasant personality, way before the teacher ever tried to put me on the spot to say yes or no. She had always been nice, as far as I could tell. She did not come across to me at that time as being rather snobbish or stuck up. She didn't even have a haughtiness about her because she was a senior in high school and I was a mere either a sophomore or a junior. She was just nice. I had been impressed with those qualities and she had demonstrated and other qualities over time. And I had begun to ignore those qualities till I was put on the spot by the teacher. For she had a beauty, a prettiness, that was more than just a physical appearance. And I was impressed with her. And even to this date, I still can recall her. I remember her character, her personality. And she was nice. There is a saying someone wrote one time. His name is Randy G. Fine. And I can't tell by his name if it's a man or woman. But anyway, he wrote one time that outward beauty is a gift, but inner beauty is an accomplishment. I feel she had accomplished that because, brother, I can still remember her some 52, 53 years have come and gone. I can only hope that my answer at that time had in reality gone beyond the standard meaning of pretty in the physical sense, but of pretty in her character, in her personality traits. It reminds me of how God instructs us to be in this life and how to react and be to people, especially in these trying times, that the soul-searching times that we've been going through here of late. I think most of us are familiar with Philippians 4, verse 8 through 9. And if you will, turn there while I still talk. Philippians 4, verse 8 through 9. I was reminded of these verses, but I also wondered, do we actually practice these traits, these characteristics of our thought patterns, even when it is so hard to even want to do these traits sometimes in this life? But they are qualities of character in one way or the other that our Father and our Savior said that we need to be practicing. It needs to be part of our makeup of what we think, how we think. And we need to be building the character that these traits depict as we enter one day into the kingdom of God. Because in Philippians 4, 8 and 9, it reads, Paul wrote, "Finally, brethren," excuse me, "whatever things are true." Now, I wanted to be truthful, but I wanted to be tactful, as I recall that girl's personality and her character. She was pretty, but in different respects. Then it continues to say, "Whatever things are noble and just and pure, lovely, of a good report, if there be anything praiseworthy," any uplifting, positive, truthful responses in this life to situations, Paul said, "Think this way, think on these things. These things which you have learned, things you've received, and things we hear." And Paul says, "Do them. And the God of peace will be with you." And I thought about that, and I also said at times we just don't see or recognize much of these traits in this world today. Not as they were, in my opinion, back in the 50s and the 60s. Because it is my opinion that we don't see much of these character traits in our TV programs of the day. We don't see these character traits in a lot of the movies that come out. We don't see them that much in our entertainment. We don't see them, in my opinion, in the media. We don't see them in our politics, in our government. We don't see them, I think, maybe as once we may have long ago. There is an old saying, brethren, that I've heard many times. And if you can't say anything good about a person, they don't say anything at all. Because it can cause hurt feelings. It can cause anger and bitterness. If you can't say anything good, then don't say anything at all. Brethren, in God's time frame and in His mercy, He is going to be really, really nice. Nice about giving all people who will let Him what none of us have ever earned or will ever deserve. God says He desires all people to be or to become saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth of the true God. Therefore, to learn over 6,000 years and even into the millennial period of time and a little beyond, to learn to walk, to learn to think, and to learn to do God's way, to learn to be nice, to be good, because God is nice and God is good. You'll find that in Psalms 136, verse 1. God is good. Especially when all along He did not even have to create us or to create a plan for us, but He was nice. Everyone will learn that all things will work together for our good, to those who love, and in time, those who will come to love the true God. For God is love. God is nice. People shall give to all what we really can only envision at this time. That our eyes can only see so much, our ears can only hear so much, and our minds can only comprehend so much the things that God has prepared for those who will love Him because He is nice. And in our day-to-day life, as much as we can, and as much as people will allow us to be, let's be nice. And try to let people see God in you every day. And in Psalms 34, verse 8, there will come a time where all will taste and they will see. People will one day really know this of God. They will see that the Lord is nice, the Lord is good. And that makes it so much easier to be happy and blessed and to trust in Him.